Good morning. It's a pleasure and an honor for me to share some thoughts on the topic of participation. And to some extent, it will connect with the keynotes of yesterday, but please allow me to develop a slightly different sort of perspective. Maybe a gloomy perspective, so I apologize in advance. Because I would like to connect this emerging idea of participation with the present reality in our societies, in Europe, perhaps in the United States, or other places in the world. And yesterday I thought I should perhaps choose another topic, another theme, another title, something like Between Trump and Chemnitz, because that are the issues that really fascinate me, that worries me. And I think in museums we should address all these present tendencies. And again, my apologies that I'm not very much familiar with the situation in Finland. So I would like to use some of my own experiences, and perhaps in the discussion we can explore possible connections with what is happening elsewhere in Europe and what perhaps is happening in your own country here. And I would like also to emphasize that my perspective is very much on a history museum, partly a natural history museum. I'm not speaking about art, I'm not speaking about art museums, since I think it was dealt with yesterday. Well, before I start, I want to make one thing very clear. When I speak about participation, I speak about what I consider to be an indispensable cornerstone of museum work. So whatever I will say, whatever doubts I would like to share you, don't forget, I am very much in favor of participation. And participation, as I said, is indispensable. Without participation, no contemporary museum. And maybe I can illustrate that with a sort of extreme example. And Maya Ekosari yesterday mentioned already this dramatic disaster in Rio de Janeiro. A museum that was completely destroyed, not just the building, but the collection. Probably many of you have colleagues working in museums in Brazil, as I do. Or perhaps you even have colleagues and friends in this museum. And I really hope that we'll never experience something similar. But the reason I refer to this is that shortly after, or in fact within 24 hours after this disaster, students of the University of Rio, the students of Uni Rio, took the initiative to use that idea of participation to reconstruct this museum. They were inviting everybody with videos, photographs, and all sort of material to send it in order to be able to reconstruct, to make a virtual reconstruction of the museum. And soon after, staff of the museum invited people to send in photographs in order to retrieve the information that was lost, the information on the labels. And Wikipedia launched their project to collect photographs of the collection in order to restore a little bit, in a virtual sense, the collection. Of course, much can be said about this, but it shows that it is important, that it is important to involve a wider circle of people in the development of our collections, or in this particular case, the reconstruction of a collection that is lost. And one of the points that I would like to share with you is that our concern, perhaps, should not be so much to address a given community, but to create one. When I speak about community, I use this term in a very specific way, a well-defined group of people. I do not use this term community for very vague, in a very vague and general sense. Well, to go into the direction of the core content of my presentation, I would like to refer to four different projects, partly in Germany, partly in the Netherlands. And one I thought it is appropriate in my experience of Finland, mosquitoes. I think for me there is a connection between Finland and mosquitoes. So I thought it would be an appropriate start of this presentation, a study of the distribution of mosquitoes, in particular the invasive mosquito species in Germany. It is a participative project. The project started in 2012, and people that are interested to participate are invited to send mosquitoes following a certain procedure involving, for example, a careful description of the time and place of collecting. Then the specimens are being identified by specialists, and they compile the map. A very successful project between 2012 and 2015. There were 7,300 submissions of, in total, 29,000 mosquitoes. And it shows how participation can be very, very helpful in understanding the development of fauna. Another example is from the Botanical Garden in Berlin. They followed the example of a project of the Paris Jardin des Plantes, and here they speak about the herbonauten. Herbonauten are individuals, people that are interested to contribute to the study of herbarium material. Like this, here you see a conserved plant, and the problem is often to decipher the labels. They are sometimes very badly written or unclear as to geographical places. And people are invited to contribute to the project by deciphering the labels. And there are certain projects, they have many different sort of projects. And here is a specific project with some plans from the Andes. The two projects are usually described as citizen science. And for me, these are two important examples, because in the discussions of participation, I very often hear this critical comments from, what do people know? They do know a little, it's not scientific. But the whole idea of participation started in this field. Yeah? The whole idea of participation started, in fact, as a citizen science. In a more specific museum context, the City Museum in Düsseldorf invited people to help them in documenting the photographs. They call these people key workers, and the key workers are invited for their knowledge about Düsseldorf, especially Düsseldorf before the war. And they are invited to describe the different buildings. So the project is very much on a more factual information on what is seen. It does not include narratives of people that were connected with these buildings. That is different in the last project. I would like to share with you the City Museum of Zoetermeer in the Netherlands. Here, people were invited to contribute objects to the collection of the museum. The theme of this project was feeling at home in Zoetermeer. And people were asked to contribute stories and objects, what it means to them to live in Zoetermeer and to feel at home in Zoetermeer. So four different sort of projects developed from different sort of perspectives, from people that are interested to contribute without necessary knowledge. You do not need to know something about mosquitoes in order to collaborate with the organization. And in the last example, the Zoetermeer example, people are the real experts because it's their story, it's their narrative that is the core of this project. And the all these examples, and especially the last two ones, are also important for me because it was connected with a project of discussing with the people about the methods of museum. So it was, in fact, also partly an educational sort of project. Well, last year, Nina Simon was, I think, speaker at your conference here. I'm not sure whether she spoke about participation, probably not, because she moved on to a new sort of ideas, I suppose. She spoke about relevancy or something. Well, anyhow, if you are interested in participation, this, of course, is the book to read, the book that she published in 2010. But interestingly, and I come back to what I said before, interestingly, her ideas about participation, and especially her typology of participation, was based on a report written by Rick Bunny about citizen science. And maybe I'm too sensitive about this, because I have had so much comments and criticism from curators, from academics that said, well, participation can never attain the quality that we want to have in our work. Well, the whole, I repeat myself, but the whole idea of participation very much rooted in reports like this one about citizen science and public participation and its potential, and that is important also in connection with this Düsseldorf and Zoetermeer projects as a potential of informal science education. So it works in two directions. And it's a contribution to museum work, but at the same time, in contributing and being involved in a participatory project, you as a participant also get information how a museum functions, and you get introduced not just in museology, but also in the subject matter. In these specific cases, the term community is hardly used. The four examples that I give are, and that was intentional, are not examples of the involvement of specific communities. It were open invitations. This is sort of typology of the different forms of participation as developed by Rick Bonney and used by Nina Simon. And people were invited in these projects that I mentioned either to contribute or to collaborate. But the last example, the Zoetermeer example, was more going into the direction of co-creative. The mosquito project is very contributory. People asked to contribute within the framework given by the project leaders, hardly followed by an educational sort of feedback. You hardly were involved in an educational sort of process. In the Düsseldorf example, and to some extent also in the Berlin Botanical Garden example, people got feedback and they got involved in a reflection on the method and the procedures of museum work. So that was perhaps collaborative. And the Zoetermeer example was more co-creative because they were playing a sort of active role in the development of the collection, not just by donating objects to the museum, but also by sharing the stories. And as I said, all these projects here were not addressing a specific community. And so instead of a community-oriented sort of participation, it was more a form of crowdsourcing. And I think in the discourse on participation, it is important to reflect on whether you want to address a certain community or you do not want to address a certain community. And most participatory projects are community-oriented in the sense that they are directed on a certain community, that the museum selects a certain community, is involved probably in this community, and build collection, exhibition on the basis of that interaction. Well, my problem with that is how we as museums conceptualize this idea of a community. Because when you define a community, there's always this issue of inclusion and exclusion. And who are we to include or exclude certain people when we define a community? Maybe I can use one example to make myself clear. For me, it is very important that a museum is open, actively open to everybody. Now for me, it's important that museums do not exclude people. Museum, by definition, for me, should be inclusive. And so there is a long discussion to what extent, for example, a gay community is being actively involved in museum work. It started in a discussion about the involvement of gay communities, but who do we refer to if we speak about gay? Are we only speaking about homosexual men? And what does that mean, being man, being homosexual? So in the discourse, the community itself, museums, wanted to be more inclusive. So as you know, it was also mentioned yesterday, I think we tend now to speak about the LGBT community. Or others speak about GLBT community. And so what is happening here? Why is it LGBT? Why is GLBT? What do we use in our museum communication? As you know, this LGBT does not include the whole specter of human identity. So should we use LGBT, or should we use LGBTQ? Or should we use LGBTIQA? Or should we choose LGBT, etc.? Now, I'm not trying to make a joke. I'm very serious, because it shows how sensitive these issues is, and how sensitive it is in any sort of definition. Who do we include, and do we exclude? Who do we actively include, and who do we want to address, and who do we forget to address? And who decides? Yeah? And in my opinion, I'm perhaps oversensitive in that, but I think museums should not decide who belongs to a certain community. And maybe community itself should not decide. So I'm very much in favor of a sort of more a way of communicating, focusing on the individual rather than on the group. It's about the individual, who he or she, to what community he or she wants to belong. Maybe today it's one community, tomorrow it's another community. Our identities are flexible, depend on the context. So that's why I'm very much in favor of crowdsourcing, this idea of crowdsourcing. The idea of crowdsourcing was introduced by Jeff Ho in 2006, and he published the book in 2008. And interestingly, he developed this idea first in connection with museum work, but he's not very much a museum person. But I found his ideas very helpful. You can read, crowdsourcing is an act of taking a job traditionally performed by a designated agent and outsourcing it. That is, agent is the curator, for example. Yeah? So the jobs traditionally performed in a museum by a curator or other museum staff could be outsourced, and now it's important, outsourced to an undefined, generally large group of people in the form of an open call. Undefined. That is what I was referring to when I had so my hesitations about defining a community. A generally large group of people. Could be anybody who feels interested, who wants to be engaged in the form of an open call. And that was important, for example, in these projects that I showed you. All an open call. Everybody can contribute. This idea of crowdsourcing is very much related to ideas developed a few years before by James Surovici about the wisdom of the crowd, and connects very well with a publication of Charles Leadbeater and Paul Miller, the Pro-M revolution. Pro-M revolution, here is the whole spectrum of expertise about knowledge. It goes to people that are devoted to a topic, but not without specific expertise, and on the right-hand side of this diagram, the full-fledged professionals. And the hypothesis of Leadbeater and Miller is that the future of our work is very much in this group of people that are serious and committed, they're quasi-professionals, but not necessarily studied, and not necessarily having an academic study in that specific area and not being employed by a museum. I see here a connection with the very origin of museums. When we look at the origin of museums in the second half of the 18th century, the period of Enlightenment, it was very much a group of proems that created the museums. So it is nothing that should worry us. On the contrary, perhaps we should be re-inspired by these ideas of the late 18th century and re-establish connections with these groups of people. In preparation of my visit to your country, I read the publication Museums as Mirrors of Society by Janne Vilkona and Pio Vorinen, published last year. You probably are familiar with this brochure. I am intrigued by the metaphor of mirror. Are we as museums, are we mirror of society? And should we be? In the title of my presentation, I used in tune. Are we in tune? Should we be in tune? What does being a mirror or being in tune mean when we speak about participation? And does participation makes us a better mirror or better in tune? So please allow me to use some German experience to elaborate on this point. Perhaps not giving answers, but sharing my worries and sharing the relevancy of these questions now, particularly in this time. As Temu mentioned, I live partly in Berlin and partly in a small village in the north of Bohemia. In between the two places, there is the Lausitz. So we travel very often from north to south, from south to north, through the Lausitz. The Lausitz is the eastern part of Saxony. And so, to some extent, Saxony very much defines my perspective on professional and personal life. And I suppose you have a general notion of what is going on at this moment. Leipzig is the city where the movement started that in November 1989 led to the fall of the wall and a lot later the fall of the German Democratic Republic. Dresden is the city where the Pegida movement started in 2014. You know, Pegida stands for patriotic Europeans against the Islamization of, let's say, Germany. Recently, as you very well know, Chemnitz was on the front page of international newspapers with its right-wing extremist demonstrations after the 26th of August. But also the Wir sind mehr, we are more manifestation of the 3rd of September. How do museums respond to these events? Should they respond? Can they respond? Honestly, museums in Saxony hardly do so. To give you an example, the Burgschloss Museum is the museum of the history of the city of Chemnitz. Looking at its website, it seems as if the museum represents a sort of parallel world where everything is nice and beautiful. That's what the Germans call a heile Welt. They have an exhibition now about a monastery. And somewhat ironic, there's an excursion to Saxony as the country of saints. Of course, it's easy and unfair to judge museums in this way. Of course, I know that exhibitions and accompanying programs are prepared long in advance. But still. Notable exceptions in Saxony are, for example, the Hygiene Museum in Dresden. Here you see the Hygiene Museum, and at the very moment, and not by coincidence, they have an exhibition about racism. And although you may criticize this exhibition as being too academic, as you can see, their educational program is quite explicit. Like today, they have a discussion on the mobilizing of the right-wing movement using internet. Another example of a museum that wants to take position in this are the ethnographical museums at Dresden and Leipzig. On its Facebook site, the museum in Leipzig was proud to say that some of their workers were participating in the demonstration We Sind More in Chemnitz. So participation is hardly a theme in Saxony. One of the most important participatory projects in the last few years was the Erfahrung DDR Mach mit exhibition in the Cultural History Museum of Görlitz. People were invited to bring objects that reminded them of the period before 1989-1990, a project rather similar to the Zoetermeer project. And in this case, what did it mean to live in the German Democratic Republic? And how do we remember it? What sort of objects that remember us of the GDR are we still using, or are we keeping as a sort of a souvenir? It was a crowdsourcing project, which was very well received throughout the Görlitz wider community. The museum emphasized its intention to give voice to the citizens of Görlitz and not to judge. Even though the general purpose was not to foster a feeling of nostalgia, there was hardly a critical reflection on the GDR as totalitarian state. The past was not idealized, but hardships were mostly mentioned as a matter of fact. The general tendency to gloss over German democratic history is often criticized. In a German academic context, it's quite impossible to speak about the GDR other than as totalitarian state. So, to some extent, the Görlitz exhibition is an attempt to give the local population the possibility to reclaim their history, the history that was stolen. I don't know if that's the right word, but the history was taken from them by the academics. And that was their history, with its good and its bad, but it was their history. But it reminded me of a participatory project recently in the City Museum of Potsdam. Children in Potsdam, school children, were asked to interview old people about their experiences during the Second World War, basically when these old people were the same age as the children that interviewed them now. An exhibition was made on the basis of these interviews and supporting objects. Visiting this exhibition, I had a sort of uneasy feeling. It appeared that most of the old people identified themselves as innocent victims. Well, this is, of course, not in line with the dominant academic rhetoric, neither with the common rhetoric in German museums, defining all these Germans as being victims. Was it reclaiming their history? Was it an example of redefining history on the basis of their own experiences? Yes, being a child, but still, can we present these stories without any sort of context? So, returning to Görlitz, the museum was very eager to say, we are taking a sort of neutral stand. We are not judging, we're just sharing all these stories because it's a story of the people of Görlitz. But can we do that? Can we be neutral? Can we abstain of providing a sort of framework for what was really happening? But what was really happening? What is the perspective you take? The outsider perspective, insider perspective, how does that balance? But I was in this exhibition several times, and I spoke with several visitors, all locals of my age. A consistent variable among the lenders as well as the visitors was a feeling of being taken serious. And I think trust is a keyword here. Yesterday, Merete spoke about accountability. I would like to connect the concept of accountability with the concept of trust. In this introductory text, the museum said, well, we are happy that you, the lenders, trusted us. And of course, trust is the basis of any participatory sort of project. A project will never succeed if the participants do not trust the museum, and vice versa. The museum should trust the participants. But what does that mean in the sort of context that I mentioned? If we speak about Pegida, if we speak the AfD, the Alternative for Deutschland as a political party, what does trust in this case mean? Can you, should you, as a museum, trust them? Trust people that are involved in this? It is an open question. I have not yet a very, very clear answer to that. But as you understand, I'm worried. Since trust is so important, how is the relation between us as museum professionals with them? I'm deliberately using this as them dichotomy. Out in the field. This is the result of the elections in Chemnitz last year. You see the AfD is a quarter of the population. Now, I do not want to define those that voted for the AfD. Yeah? Because, you know, it's a wide diversity of people. I do not want to identify them as neo-Nazis, no. But are we aware of that? And what happens if in next year there are the elections in Saxony? What will happen then with the AfD? What will happen if the AfD is the biggest party in Saxony? What will happen on the level of the ministry? What will happen in the community? There is a tension, we have to be very clear about, a tension between the general political orientation of museum curators and a larger part of the people we want to be relevant for. We are accountable to the wider community. How do we see our perhaps different perspectives on sort of fundamental issues? And that's why I think there's so much talking now about being neutral. Can, should museums be neutral? Can, should museums work with all groups in the society? What does it mean, inclusion and exclusion? Should we exclude those who voted for the AfD? No, I'm not suggesting that, of course. But still, do we share the same perspective on the world? Do we share the same perspective on the relevant issues in our society? I think basically we should be honest. We should be transparent, and we should take this concept of trust very seriously. And perhaps in the end, it means that we are not neutral. But if we are not neutral, we should be honest and transparent in what choices we made. We should be honest and transparent in what our ideas are. Right? This accountability, trust are based on honesty and transparency. Not by coincidence, transparency is a key ethical concept in this important book on museum ethics. So if we are transparent, if we honor trust, and if we are honest in what we do, we can have perhaps, hopefully, and that should be the intention, to have dialogue with the diversity of people. And crowdsourcing is a main instrument here. Being open to everybody, not in advance excluding people, being inclusive as possible. So include this multi-perspectivity, being transparent, accepting a diversity of views that live in society. And when the participants are open for this dialogue, of course you as a museum should welcome that and participate in that. That is openness and this dialogue that contributes to the relevancy of your project and your institution. It shows that you're willing to engage, that as a museum you engage with the different groups in the society and in the other way around, that people have the possibility to participate and to be engaged in the sort of discourse that you have inside the museum. And as such, I think one of the key principles here is that the method is the message. That engagement means that people start to understand why you are there. What is the purpose of a museum? By its understanding, you contribute, I think, to your accountability and the trust that is exercised in this community. Perhaps by doing so, we can sort of reverse this, this idea that we move, as I told you, from community perspective to crowdsourcing, but by engaging people in your activities, you create a community, your community of support, your community of passion. Thank you so much.